As many cities are facing chaos and violence, my next guest says the radical left is doing all the wrong things to fix systemic problems in low-income urban communities. He's a longtime civil rights activist who says that the problems and the solutions come from within. Please welcome the founder of the Woodson Center, Bob Woodson. Bob, let's talk about what we hear a term, systemic racism. Is that what's wrong with America today, systemic racism?
I have no idea what that means. I think it's really being used as a ruse so that we can avoid addressing the fundamental questions that if racism were the principal cause of the urban decay that exists in all the cities around the country, then why does this condition exist with black officials running these institutions? And so but I think as long as we can concentrate on external factors like systemic racism, we can avoid asking the critical questions of why are blacks, low-income blacks, failing in systems run by their own people, the school boards, the city councils, the jails, the hospitals, the foster care systems. So I think it's being used, Governor, to deflect attention away from these very critical questions.
I've heard you say, and I've read things that you've written about, that the family structure, the breakdown of a traditional family, the lack of fathers in so many of young black males' lives is a huge factor. I've been on the Black Lives Matter website, and one of their stated goals, and I challenge people to go to their website, read it for themselves, one of their stated goals is to get rid of the traditional family where a father is involved. That seems shocking to me that the very thing that you've just said is most important is the one thing that the Black Lives Matter movement would love to destroy, a mother, father, raising children in a traditional family.
Well, that's why the Black Lives Matter movement and is really not about trying to seek justice for blacks. They are using and abusing the rich legacy of the civil rights movement and taking America's birth defect of slavery and using it as a bludgeon to really destroy civil institutions in America. It's really about attacking the nation's founding principles. And unfortunately, low-income blacks are collateral damage in that effort on part of the left to really destabilize and change our way of life.
Black-on-black crime in major cities, whether it's Chicago, which may be the worst, but New York City, Detroit, Atlanta, gets very little attention in the news media. Why is that, Bob?
Because it does not fit the left's narrative to talk about. Everything has to be examined through the intersectional lens of race. And so it does not fit that narrative. For instance, there are about 14 blacks who are unarmed who are shot by the police every year. For every one that are shot, 270 blacks kill one another. Of the homicides, more blacks have killed other blacks in 1 year than 50 years of the Klan.
You know, I have noticed that a lot of the major corporations of our country are donating money to Black Lives Matter. And as a slogan, I think we all agree, yeah, of course Black Lives Matter. We're talking about the organization, which is not some innocent group of do-gooders. This is a Marxist organization that would love to see fundamental institutions of America overthrown. You have just spoken to it. One of the institutions is that of the police department. We hear moves to defund the police. Virginia is now working on legislation that would make it no more than a misdemeanor to attack a police officer. Speak to that. Is it dangerous for us to devalue law enforcement at a time when laws are being completely ignored?
Every time police are attacked for being racist in the community, it means they are less aggressive enforcing laws in those high crime neighborhoods. And the consequence has been the murder rates soar in the absence of police. And many of the people who are picketing to defund the police are themselves living in gated communities where they are safe. And so many of the advocates for defund the police do not have to suffer the consequence of their advocacy. But when you ask grassroots people what they want the police.
Before I let you go, Bob, I've got to ask you about the 1776 Unites project that you are working with. Tell me what your goals are, and if people want to help you with that, how do they do it?
Well, the goals of 1776 is to offer a counter-narrative to 1619. We're not entering into gladiatorial debate. We're going to offer inspirational and aspirational stories about blacks who were born slaves who died millionaires. Blacks in Chicago that in 1929, at 731 businesses, 100 million in real estate assets. We want to tell stories of resilience and perseverance in the presence of oppression. We're going to develop in children's books. We want a curriculum that celebrates the glories of the American system and how some of those blacks who were born slaves, who died millionaires, actually purchased the plantation on which they were slaves, and one of them actually took in the family of the slave master, which evidenced the kind of radical grace that was practiced by people at that time. So there are a lot of fascinating stories about resilience and triumph in the face of oppression that America needs to be, children need to know.
Well, I want to tell you something. You're one of my favorite people. You've certainly reminded me why. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
You can follow Mr. Woodson on Twitter at Bob Woodson and at Woodson Center. And check out all the positive work he's doing over at 1776united.com.